I need a job. God, would you bless my stock markets to, oh God, I need a new car. God, I need you. Why would we serve him? Why would anybody serve him? Because of what he gives us, not because of who he is.
Yeah.
Well, everybody would serve him. You know? He wants you to serve him because of who he is, because he's a good God.
Amen.
Because he's a loving God. Yeah. Because he's a merciful God, full of grace, full of wantonness to share with you, in pursuit of you when you go astray. Because he wants you. He wants you. God's not abandoning us. He's suffering with us. He came into this earth to demonstrate his willingness to be acquainted with our human condition and to redeem us out of it. God knows suffering and pain experientially. He knows experientially what we're going through. God suffers with us. God weeps with us. Not only does God suffer with us, but most of all, what says something most powerful about the nature of God is that God suffers for us. God suffers for his creation. Now keep in mind that God is exposed to suffering only at his will. It was the Lord's will to crush him, Isaiah 53. Okay? Only in God's will is he going to allow himself to suffer. So God has will that he will allow himself to suffer pain, even death, for his creation. Okay? And the supreme example of the deep-seated emotions of God is not seen any more clear than in a crucified God. The crucified God. It is suffering spurred on by deep-seated emotion, by deep-seated love, by passionate love. He is passionate for you. That's why he died for you. And if you were the only one, he would still do it. You know what? I met a girl the other day from Sudan. And she lived, I guess she was 16 when she came to America. Now, I have such a heart for the Sudanese. I've read their stories and what they've gone through. If you don't know, North Sudan is mostly Muslim, South Sudan is Christian, and 2 million Christians have died over the course of some years in genocide. You know, it's one of my things that I feel like the international community should have stepped in and done something. I mean, that is a horrible genocide. And nothing's been done. They did in 2011. They separated and became two separate states, but it hasn't stopped. There's still problems, you know? But she spent all of her life in a refugee camp. 16 years of her life in a refugee camp was what she called home. You know what? God was there. And you know what? I'll bet you anything. But she said, oh, we're all Christians. That's our faith. You know what? I bet you could feel the presence of God in that refugee camp.
Yes.
More than about anywhere in the world. Because he was there. You say, well, Natalie, what about the 2 million that died? What about the boys and the girls who were running to get away from the war and they stepped on grenades? You know, or the lions ate them because they got too weak to keep going, or the coyotes got them, or the ones who just starved to death. Or the ones who just fell in the heat of the desert and lost hope and lost faith and their carcasses left there for the birds to eat. What about them? What about the ones that were recruited by the enemy, the Muslim community, and forced them to become child soldiers? What about them? What about the girls who were exploited? What about them, Natalie? You know what I got to say about that? I look back at the early church, the first martyr of the church, Stephen. And you know, when they're standing there stoning him, he looks up. And anybody remember what he said?
Yep.
I see one like the Son of God standing at the right hand of God.
Right.
You know why he's standing? Because where's his position usually? He's usually sits at the right hand of the Father. No, he's standing because the one he loves, his child, the one he died for, is dying.
Yeah.
He's standing because he cares.
Right.
He passionately cares.
Yeah.
And he's identifying in solidarity with that death. He's identifying in solidarity with that suffering.
Right.
He's standing. demands his attention.
Right.
Hallelujah.
He's standing.
That's good.
You know? Man, if we just knew how much God loves us, if we just knew how much, so much is a suffering God. There's no other religion on the face of the earth that embraces a crucified God. That's weak. That's weak in the mindset. No, it's like the Babylonian creationism God that stands at the top and rules over everything. No. You see, God allowed himself to be demonstrated in weakness. A crucified God. That's how much he loves us. You know? It doesn't matter what how we messed up. God designed, think about this. We are the object of God's wrath. Technically. Are we not supposed to be? We fell in the garden, sinned against God, a holy God. Are we, apart from Christ, all we know of theology, are we not supposed to be the objects of God's wrath? Right?
Amen.
But see, the special thing about God is this. God's desire to love the object deserving of his wrath. You got that? God desires to love the object deserving of his wrath. Don't we all deserve hell? God chooses to love us. Love triumphs over wrath at the cross. We're deserving of his wrath. We're deserving of hell. But love triumphs over wrath at the cross.
Right.
That's what it's about.
Amen.
We don't get wrath. Instead, we get a crucified God.
Mm-hmm.
A God who said, I'll die in your place.
Yes. Oh, yes. Thank you, Jesus.
You know, the crucifixion of Christ is divine solidarity with the sinner. Solidarity means you're in getting in their shoes. He's a holy God. He stayed holy, but he got in our shoes. You know, suffered with us and suffered for us. God doesn't have special interest groups. He doesn't have special interest groups. All lives matter. Everyone matters. The biggest sinner still matters to him. See, God, he's willing to die for you because his love is so great. The crucifixion of Christ is divine solidarity. He's getting in the shoes of the sinner. And yet he's holy. The Creator took on the form of his creation. That's divine humiliation. He faced a defeated foe, Satan, whom he created, by the way. Are y'all getting this? He's facing a defeated foe, someone he created, and yet he's victorious over him, but he's having to be tempted by him. Yeah, divine humiliation. Eternal God facing death. On a cross, which is the curse. So he came under the curse. Divine humiliation. God being rejected by his creation. What's he saying, John? He says to you, he came unto his own, or literally the Greek is, he came to his home. His home. And his own received him not. Divine humiliation. You see, God went to the extent, great extent, to redeem you, to let you know he's welcoming, he's inviting, he wants a relationship. Nancy, I know you know the Greek word from Philippians, where it says he emptied himself. Okay? I'll flip there real quick. I didn't have this plan, but it popped into my head. Philippians. It says here, being in the very nature God, but Christ being in the very nature God, same nature, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but he made himself nothing, or he emptied himself. The word kenosis, he emptied himself. He emptied himself of his divine, all-encompassing power, his all-knowing ability, because he limited himself into the form of man. So he emptied himself. God was wounded emotionally and physically at the crucifixion. You think about it. What happened when he's being crucified? The whole sky turned dark, right? That's the wrath of God. That's the pathos of God. The anger of God. But instead of reaching down and grabbing a hold of the throats of those who were yelling out, "Crucify him," instead of yanking the nails and the hammer out of the hands who were hammering the nails in and crucifying Jesus, instead, he reached down and he grabbed hold of that curtain at the top, the one that separates the holy place from the holy of holies, the one that only the priests could enter in one time a year on the Day of Atonement.
Yes.
That one. He grabbed a hold of that and he rent it from top to bottom.
That's right. Amen.
Why? Because he was saying, come on in.
Yes.
Amen. I'm a welcoming God. I want you to see my holiness. I want to embrace you. I want to love you. You're a sinner. I'm a holy God. But I tell you, come on in is what he's saying. I'm inviting. I'm welcoming. I'm loving. I'm gracious. I'm forgiving. Come on in. That's what he's saying. You see? He's welcoming. God came into our suffering and he owned it. He has all of himself invested in creation. He has all of himself invested in you. He owned our sin. He owned our pain. He owned our predicament.
Yes, he did.
He owned it. Thus, suffering is overcome by suffering. Did y'all get that?
Amen.
Suffering, our suffering, is overcome by his suffering. Our suffering as sinners, sinners deserving to be separated from God eternally, is absorbed through Christ's suffering. Thus, within the sufferings of Christ is the end of all suffering in the future. He suffered that all suffering might pass away. He suffered that there might be redemption and fellowship restored to his creation. He desires to have us closer. That's the nature of God. A divine being suffering and dying in our place. And I have the audacity to accuse God of doing nothing for me. He gave everything for me. But you know what? It's resurrection that is divine triumph over all suffering. And the resurrection of Christ, I can't preach that he died until I say something about his resurrection. Because it's in the resurrection that we have hope.
That's right.
That there's no more suffering.
That's right.
We have hope, Debbie, of seeing our loved ones we've lost in the resurrection. You know? We have hope because he rose from the dead.
Yes.
What does this mean to us? It means we are so very, very loved. It means that salvation is transformational and we are being changed from moment to moment into the likeness of God. He bears with us. He pursues us. He pulls us along sometimes. You know? It also means, though, that God is holy, and holiness is not an option. It also means that as recipients of forgiveness, that to pledge your allegiance to Christ means that you too must share in the work of forgiving men their sins. It means we're not there yet, but he is here with us. Suffering with us. He said, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you.